So today, we'll start to dig deeper into the first vital sign of the economy, GDP. To get a better idea of GDP, we will first define what GDP is, why it's a measure of well-being, then we will discuss how we use GDP to analyze the economy. We use GDP as a measure of a country's income. It will give us an idea of how much money is produced in the economy. As GDP increases, we expect that the people are better off. When GDP falls, we'll expect that people are worse off in the economy. This is simplified, and to learn more about GDP, we will first have to define it. The definition of gross domestic product is the market value of all final goods and services produced in a nation within a specific period of time. I'd like to focus on several things in that definition. First, GDP measures the value of what is produced. So it is not enough to measure the quantity that is produced. Just measuring quantities will lead to inaccurate analysis. For GDP, we are interested in measuring value of production, which means we will have to multiply the quantities produced by the prices of those goods and services we produced. Second thing about GDP is that we are interested in counting final goods only, or final goods and services only. We define final goods as goods sold to the final consumer. Compare that to an intermediate good. Intermediate goods are goods used in the production of other goods. We do not count intermediate goods because when we count the final good, it will also include the value of the intermediate good within the price of the final good. If we count both intermediate and final goods, we would be double counting. As an example, consider GMC. They buy 4 tires from Firestone to put on their truck to sell to you. Those 4 tires are considered intermediate goods. When GMC sells the truck, the value of the tires would be included in the total value of the car. Therefore, there is no need to count the tires in the intermediate purchasing process. If you'd like to think of it in a different way, think about your reaction if GMC tried to sell you a truck without tires. I would assume you'd be willing to pay less for that truck. Third thing to keep in mind about GDP is that it measures activity within an economy. The measure GDP looks at domestic production regardless of who is producing it. We are interested in the amount of activity within a country. There are other measures of income that measure production of firms from a single country regardless of their location. That measure is called gross national product. It measures how much nationals of a specific country, regardless of their location, are producing. Both are measures of economic activity, but GDP is used more often in the US. Finally, GDP is measured for a specific time frame. When discussing GDP, we need to be clear about the time in which we are interested in. It means nothing to the audience if we say GDP is $19.2 trillion. A more accurate way of expressing that is to say GDP of the United States of America was $19.2 trillion in 2019. Most of the time, we'll report GDP by year. However, in the US, GDP data is made available quarterly. Therefore, we can follow our progress every 3 months if we wanted to. The assumption we will make is that GDP measures the value of what is produced in the country. It is a measure of income and a measure of living standards. Therefore, it is a measure of well-being. Now that you know what GDP is, how do we use it in economics? We will use GDP for 3 main reasons. 1, to estimate living standards across time and nations. 2, to identify the business cycle. 3, to measure economic growth over long periods of time. Let's look at these in more detail. This graph allows us to see how we can estimate living standards across time and nations. I love this graph because it says so much and gets me thinking. On the x-axis, we have time. Specifically, we are looking at the time period between 1950 and to 2010. On the y-axis, we have per capita GDP in 1990 dollars. We will define this in more detail later on. For now, think of it as the average annual income per person. The graph presents six different countries. These countries had roughly the same income per person in 1950. As time went on, these economies' experiences were very different. Let us take a look at India. Income per person was below $1,000 per year in 1950. It grew gradually till about 1990, then something happened. The growth rate changed. The living standards increased. In 2010, the living standards were more than three times that of 1950. What happened in India in 1991? This is why I love looking at this data. We can use economic to recognize historical moments. I won't give it away. See if you can figure it out and see what happened in India. Let's look at Nicaragua. Something happened in Nicaragua around, say, 1979, 1980. In a short time period, income per person fell from $3,000 per year to $2,000. That's a steep decline in living standards in such a short time frame. More importantly, living standards never recovered. What happened in Nicaragua? Does this make you curious? Looking at these graphs, it makes me want to learn more. Once again, this is for you to find out. Look into it. Is there something else that catches your attention in this graph? Maybe Poland? Poland looks interesting. It has similar growth pattern like Mexico. Then right before the 1990s, living standards fell. But after 1990, the Polish economy grew faster and living standards today are much higher than in Mexico and Turkey. What happened in Poland in 1990? Right before 1990 or after 1990? Once again, so much to learn from one graph. It opens up a whole world of questions. It allows us to compare and contrast economies, to learn about history. I can't wait till you report back to me what you find out. We will use GDP to measure the business cycle. The business cycle is the short-run fluctuations in the economy, the ups and downs that the economy experiences. As we move from month to month, quarter to quarter, year to year, we'll want to know how the economy is doing. This is why we measure the business cycle. In this graph, we can see an economy that experiences changing output. Sometimes it's growing, and other times GDP is decreasing. This is what we call expansions and contractions. Contractions are also known as recessions. Business cycles have peaks and troughs. The distance between a peak and a trough is when the GDP is falling. So we are in a recession or contraction. Distance between trough and peak is associated with growing GDP. The economy is expanding or in an expansion phase. This is what a business cycle is. Finally, we will use GDP to measure long-run growth. Here, we're interested in the changes in GDP over decades or generations. For example, we're interested in the difference between your living standards and the living standards of your parents at your age. Obviously, since this is a macroeconomics class, we are interested in the overall difference for everyone, not just you specifically. Economic growth is the long-run trend of our GDP. Let us use GDP to talk about your GDP experience. This is a graph from the Federal Reserve Economic Data, also known as FRED. FRED is an online tool to help you collect and graph economic data. You can easily recreate the graph. I'll provide you a link below for you to try it out. In this graph, I present US real GDP per person starting the fourth quarter of 2001 and ending in the first quarter of 2020. For someone born in the last 3 months of 2001, this graph will tell their GDP story. In the fourth quarter of 2001, GDP per person was $46,386. In the first quarter of 2020, the GDP per person was $57,581. This is in real terms, which means that it is controlling for changes in prices. So over your lifetime, the average income per person has grown by roughly $11,000 per year. You will notice there is one shaded area in this graph. The gray area indicates periods where the US economy was officially in a recession. From 2008 to 2009, the US economy GDP fell. That recession is now known as the Great Recession. You will also notice that GDP fell during other periods of times, most recently in the first quarter of 2020. But it is not shaded. That's because to officially be considered a recession, GDP must decline two consecutive quarters. Want to know my GDP story? Here it is. I was born in the first quarter of 1981. The GDP per person was $30,316. This is in real terms. So we can compare GDP per person in 2001 to GDP per person when I was born. That's a difference of roughly $16,000. I attended my first semester of college in August of 1997. Yes, if you're doing the math, I was 16 when I started college. It's a long story, and maybe one day I'll tell you about it. GDP per person was $42,487. When I first attended college, I experienced two recessions before I got to college. First, as a newborn in the recession that started at the end of 1981, then again in 1991. Between my birth and college, GDP per person grew by $12,171. Looking at these graphs is a lot of fun. It is amazing how much we can learn and say about the world. There is more to learn that will help us evaluate the state of the economy. I encourage you to try your own FRED graph using time horizons that interest you. Share your graph with me and the class. Geek out, post them on social media. Make sure to tag me. To recap, today we learned about GDP and how it is defined. We also learned about the different ways to use GDP. Finally, we learned about FRED and access to data. There is so much more to learn. I look forward to seeing you in the next class.